man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. Every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret.
Lee's Black Spy, an agent of the Confederate Cavalry Intelligence Service, by Carl Burkhalter. The South won many victories against long odds because of the information supplied by the Confederate Cavalry Intelligence Service, which penetrated to the very heart of the U.S. War Department, and from there quite often into Union field headquarters, regularly transmitting to Lee Union orders before they were received by Union line officers. The many Union embarrassments were not so much the fault of incompetent Union generals as they were the amateurish way Cameron and Stanton conducted their affairs, politicians interfering with military professionals. The North was not aware of how badly they had been played until after the war, when they read captured Confederate military records, and even then weren't sure how it happened. Certainly it wasn't something they wanted to discuss. Stanton was long dead, for example, before General Fitz John Porter was exonerated for his wrongful conviction for the defeat at the Battle of Second Manassas, also known as Second Bull Run. What records Secretary Stanton hadn't burned were classified until 1953. Documents and other evidence continued to surface for the first time well into the 1970s. Thus, Shelby Foote can be forgiven for seeing the hand of divine providence in these affairs. Had he known fully the scope of the Confederate operatives, he would have known that these miracles had rational explanations. And this black spy was one of those explanations. Okay, we might not know his identity, but the man existed. No doubt about that, and he won at least one major Confederate battle, if not two, by the work he did, and quite possibly more. This is his story, and I think it's important. The Union War Department was vulnerable because its chief architect became the Confederate president. During his tenure as Secretary of War, this West Point graduate, who had proven himself in Mexico, particularly at Buena Vista, modernized and upgraded weapons and communications. Much of the staff of the department owed their employment to him. Officers who would later resign to join the Confederacy stayed in Washington preparing an espionage network even before there was a Confederate States of America because of their loyalty to Davis. Agents sent to spy on the Confederacy were often identified before they left Washington and spoon-fed disinformation from the moment they arrived in Richmond. McClellan is often severely criticized, for example, for thinking the Confederate forces in Virginia were twice their actual size, but his information came from the War Department and its agents. Whose fault is this, his or theirs? Just before the Civil War, conflict along the Mexican border would reach a fever pitch as the central Mexican government descended into anarchy that would lead to French occupation. Northern Mexican states attempted to reassert their authority over the Hispanic territories in Texas that they felt were rightfully theirs. Governor Sam Houston demanded a greater federal commitment to border security. This would remain an issue well into the future, in case you haven't noticed. And General Winfield Scott responded by sending a regiment of his best troops under the man he considered his best officer, a lieutenant colonel named Lee. Lee rode from the entire Rio Grande from Eagle Pass to Brownsville, looking to confront the Mexican forces under the Mexican General Juan Cortina. But the wily Mexican shadowed Lee's forces the entire time and avoided a showdown. Lee declared victory after arriving in Brownsville. His best intelligence was that Cortina and his men were 500 miles to the south in the Mexican mountains. As Lee was leaving Brownsville,
Cortina reoccupied the city, leaving Lee to ponder on his long ride back to Virginia just how he had been fooled. Men he thought he could trust had lied to him, and men he knew he could trust had been the victims of Cortina's theatric talent. One Cortina had literally been reading his mail. Rather than becoming enraged, Lee chalked it up to lessons learned and proceeded to apply these lessons in his next assignment. So besides the head start you have in the Confederate intelligence operations that Davis provided, you also have Lee contributing some finesse from his recent experiences in Mexico. Cortina would later join Juarez. He was an ally of the Union. He always knew which side to go on. The man was genius. He would later join Juarez and provide critical support in his victory over Maximilian. He would later go on to be governor and display his brilliance for the rest of his life. I have read everything I could find about Civil War intelligence operations. They all start out with how this book is hampered by the fact Confederate Secretary of State Judah Benjamin, like Union Secretary of War Edwin Stanton, burned all the official records, and how General Norris and the other high-ranking Confederate intelligence chiefs burned their records as well. This leaves the highest-ranking intelligence operative on the Confederate side to leave us anything of value to be Captain Thomas Conrad, who wrote of these things 30 years after the fact. It appears at first glance to be the senile ramblings of an old man, writing in third and first person indiscriminately back and forth and basically being able to get to the point. But these are only his technique for telling us what happened without getting himself hung for his part in the Lincoln assassination. He was clearly involved not only with the plotters, who he did not realize would change the game plan from kidnapping to murder, and he definitely involved in the capture of Booth, but that is another video altogether. Conrad tells us about a black agent named William who helped him in scouting ahead so he could find his way through the Union pickets when he was going through the lines. Near the end of the war, when Conrad was working in counterintelligence in Richmond, this William shot and killed a Union courier. Okay, many of the books about the Civil War will tell us there was no such thing as a black Confederate spy. This book is the first one where I found the existence of the plot of the spy who this video is about. General Rozier's book confirms the story about the spy, and at that point goes off on only one of two asides in the whole book. Rozier, obviously a man of action and a few words, was remiss in submitting official reports during the war, from the time he became a general. Wade Hampton requested he submit them after the war to flesh out the official records, so the book basically reads like an attachment to those records. Just military action, who, when, and where. Conrad was a highly educated teacher in Georgetown when the war broke out, and it wasn't until early 1862, after a stint in the old Capitol prison, that he got mad enough to join the Confederate Army. Okay, this was about the time the first head of the Confederate Washington Bureau, Mrs. Rose Greenough, and her whole operation were made, so Davis needed another operative in Washington to facilitate his War Department contacts. So, Jeb Stuart took Conrad directly to Davis, who was unknown at that point to anybody in the Confederate Army in the war, and Davis and Conrad had a few private dinners. Conrad's most valued possession, even after the war, was a signed thank you letter from President Davis. Okay, so he operated in and around Washington for about 2 years before being made by Union Colonel Lafayette Baker. But Conrad had agents in the Federal Detective Agency and was warned in plenty of time to get out of town. Okay, he returned to his assigned unit. Stuart had had him officially commissioned chaplain of the 3rd Virginia Cavalry as captain from the very beginning. Okay, he was serving as an advanced scout around June 9, 1864, and this happened. It happened that I was scouting on our left when I saw a bluecoat some distance off emerging from a thicket and advancing toward me. I rode toward the fellow, prepared for a contest, until I discovered it was an unarmed mulatto in Yankee uniform. He approached me and asked if I were a Confederate officer, and upon answering in the affirmative, he stated that he had just escaped from Sheridan's headquarters and had information that he knew was very important to us. Now, in all the Civil War literature, everything I've read, this was the first time I ever heard about this man. Conrad could get information to Richmond in 24 hours or less. Okay, intelligence is like fish. It goes bad just like after 3 days. So getting it is one thing, but getting it out quickly enough to matter is quite another. And Conrad certainly did get his information there in a timely fashion. Okay, in this particular incident, the agent realized that what he had was so time sensitive that he risked everything, I mean, you know, like his life, to get to Rozier quickly enough. What that was a planned cavalry raid by Sheridan of 10,000 men to link up with Hunter in the valley, destroy the Central Railroad, and essentially deprive Lee of his food supply, and burn the Shenandoah Valley, which they would do, you know, many months later. However, this kid realized that they were moving quickly and he had to go now, so he took the information to his friend General Rozier, and immediately they, as I'll show you in a minute, immediately the Confederates moved, and they moved quickly enough to set up ahead of the Union forces and dismount and prepare a defensive position. Eventually, the Confederates inflicted such terrible casualties, Sheridan was forced to retreat, and this saved the Confederacy for a time. Unfortunately for the Confederacy, it also distracted the Confederate cavalry from keeping an eye on Grant. He snuck across the James River. This kind of shows the tactical genius of Grant. I mean, you want to knock the guy a lot of times because he wasn't as smart as Lee. Well, no, he wasn't. But he knew how to use cavalry too. He could use them to distract from what was going on so he could move. He'd done it before and he would do it again this time. Grant had by far the best horse of the war, Cincinnati. He was a world record setting American champion, and he could have outrun and outperformed any other horse in the war. And I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings about Traveler or Little Sorrel or St. Philip or one of the Confederate horses. I'm sorry. But Grant knew horses. He knew what the men could do and what they could not do in the cavalry. And he never expected his cavalry to perform like the Confederates, you know, getting in the enemy's rear and cutting supplies and so forth and getting information. He knew he could send them forward. The horses knew how to go forward and charge like a battering ram, and the men were brave, and if you ordered them to do that, they could do it, and he would do that several times, just send them off willing to sacrifice the whole bunch just to distract the Confederates long enough for him to move. And I'm going to read here, which is like 90% of everything that's written in all the Civil War literature about the subject of this paper. But I'm going to start up here at the second paragraph. Sheridan with Custer had been sent to capture Gordonsville and Charlottesville and destroy the railroads, the great feeders leading from the west in the valley to Richmond. This heavy force of cavalry under the command of the vicious and intrepid leader Sheridan and the daring and dashing Custer were well underway before Hampton had divined their intent and objective points. It happened that I was scouting on our left when I saw a bluecoat some distance off emerging from the thicket and advancing toward me. I rode toward the fellow prepared for a contest until I discovered it was an unarmed mulatto in Yankee uniform. He approached me and asked if I were a Confederate officer, and upon answering in the affirmative, he stated that he had just escaped from Sherman's headquarters and had information that was very important for us to know. He further stated that he had been a servant of General Boscher in the Washington Artillery, and if the general was near, I could take him to him for identification. I inquired the nature of his information and was told that while at General Sheridan's headquarters that morning, he had had heard much about the raid and to what points they were going, etc. I told him to get up behind me and that I would take him to General Rosser's headquarters in a very few minutes. I did so. General Rosser knew him, knew when and where he was captured and all about him. The general heard all that he had to say, then sent him over to General Wade Hampton's headquarters with his information. The mulatto's statement seemed a revelation, and in less than an hour, boots and saddles were ordered and the whole cavalry corps in motion, set in motion. Couriers were sent to General Fitzhugh Lee with instructions to move at once and by forced marches, strike heavy upon coming up in rear and on the flanks of the enemy. Hampton had hardly gotten into position before Custer charged with his whole brigade and went through our center like a thunderbolt. Our forces closed up and sent off Custer and drove Sheridan back to Trevilian Station in Louisa County, Virginia. After a severe attack and heavy loss, and continued to drive him back to Grant's columns around Petersburg. The capture of the mulatto and his information thus enables Hampton and Rosser to get in position in front of Sheridan and prepare for his coming. What a godsend. Okay, I could go on about how they chased down a bunch of the Yankees and killed them all the way back home, but that's not the salient point here. This is the beginning of the fourth chapter of Rosser's book, Riding with Rosser. Okay, it's the Battle of Trevilian Station with the subtitle, The Most Important Cavalry Fight of the War. Okay, and shot in the leg. Later in this battle, he was shot in the leg. Okay, from the top. After the affair at Ashland, we were allowed to remain in bivouac near Atlee Station until the morning of the 9th, when learning that Sheridan was moving in the direction of Gordonsville. When General Hampton assembled the cavalry corps in light marching order, and we started in the same direction. Sheridan was under command of a very large force of cavalry, and the country in which Grant was operating was so very unfavorable for it to its use that it could well be spared for raids for a distant coup de main. Okay, that's a sudden military movement when necessary. And when we learned that Sheridan was moving, divined his intentions to be Lynchburg and his purpose the destruction of the railroad and canal. We've moved upon the interior in shorter lines, and our excellent scouts hung upon the flanks of the enemy and kept us accurately informed of his position and movement. A faithful servant. The night before Sheridan marched, after he had given all the necessary orders for putting the troops in motion, a Negro boy of 19 or 20 years, who was employed as a servant by one of their officers, he left camp and came into our lines. Early in the war, when I was a captain of artillery, he had attended me in the capacity of valet, and as soon as he reached the cavalry pickets, he asked to be assigned to me. He reached me late at night and in a clear and straightforward manner related all that had occurred in Sheridan's camp preparatory for this expedition, and this information was of great service to us. This Negro boy was a slave, and when I left the Washington artillery, he was returned to New Orleans by his master. When the city was captured by Federals, he was employed by an officer as a servant, and as soon as the opportunity offered itself, he returned to the Confederate Army in which his master was serving. Okay, this is one of the only two asides he goes into in the whole book. When he's not talking, you know, action, bang, 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 moving, draw, it's just make a great movie. The Negroes of the South, as a general thing, have not been behaved very well since the war, but it is not half their fault. The carpetbaggers and political adventurers who flocked to the South during the period of Reconstruction, so-called, are responsible for all the trouble the Negro man has brought on himself and the South, Southern people since the war. Now, the conduct of the Negro slave in the South during the war was commendable in the extreme.
That's the reason I underlined it. The conduct of the Negro slave in the South during the war was commendable in the extreme. All the white men were in the field, and their wives, mothers, sisters, and daughters were left at home at the mercy of the Negro slave. At the end of the war between the North and South, the destiny of his race hung, and while armies were struggling upon different distant fields of battle, he peacefully toiled in the fields and never once raised his hand against the defenseless ones at home. The Confederate cavalry service was highly compartmentalized. General officers would actually hide their spies from each other under the assumption, you know, that if you can fool your friends, it's a lot easier to fool your enemies. So they would even mark their men on the muster records as being AWOL. And just in case the Union spies got into their records and were did to the Confederates what the Confederates were doing to the Union. So, you know, it was this guy, Stringfellow, a character from Mercy Street, was actually a officer in a special company of spies. And he didn't really write much, but he became a preacher out of the war after the war and did a number of lectures about his experiences during the war in order to raise money for his churches. Okay, so this is something, this is about Catlett Station, an incident of raid that happened just prior to the Battle of Manassas. Okay, in one of his lectures, he tells how he found the location right up to Catlett Station, you know, where you could covered route, you could get within 40 or 50 yards of the station without being seen, and took credit for that capture of that station. Well, that was probably one of the greatest intelligence coups of the war, if not all time, because the Confederates captured Pope's entire staff, all of his papers, everything, his clothes, his underwear, his personal papers, and his payroll, about $350,000. They got it all. The Union officers were surprised so badly they didn't have a chance to burn anything. So this, whoever wrote this is taking this information from the lecture when he says, in August, this is, you know, the Battle of Bull Run, or Second Manassas, was at the end of August 1862. So we're moving back a couple of years here. In August, he located a large wagon train at Catlett Station and led Stuart to it, almost capturing Pope in the process. Now, because this is going to be relevant later, we're going to read the rest of this. Stringfellow was well known to the Yankees by now and a constant target of their search. One group that had been sent to find him, this group had orders to kill him on sight, but aided by a black female servant, he was able to find a tight spot in the attic in which to hide. The Yankees searched high and low and barely missed finding him. Okay, they questioned the young woman and she wouldn't tell him anything. She told him false information. Clearly, she was in with the Confederate cavalry. Now, Stuart's report contradicts the idea that Stringfellow led Stuart to Pope's headquarters that night. This comes from his official report submitted from the headquarters of the Cavalry Division, the Army of Northern Virginia, on February 23, 1864, the next year, when it, you know, finally went into the official records of the Army. Fortunately, we captured at that moment, so critical, a Negro who had known me at Berkeley and who, recognizing me, informed me of the location of Pope's staff and company and offered to guide us to the spot. After a brief consultation, it was decided to accept the Negro's proposition. You got to remember, Rosser was serving with Stuart that night. It was his first assignment in the cavalry. He jumped up from artillery captain to cavalry colonel. He was with him that night, and the young black man is reported in many places as saying he was so overjoyed to be back with his friends. Now, Stuart and Rosser and this young black man had been together on Munson's Hill in Virginia in 1861. So this, if in my opinion, he's referring back when he's talking about Berkeley, he's either referring to either that assignment or he's talking about the code name for Stringfellow. He and Lee use code names all the time in their official correspondence. You know, they figured, you know, the Union might be have spies in Richmond reading their records like the Confederates were reading
the Union records in Washington. I've been doing research for the last 3 years before I put it together that this guy was real, trying to figure out who he was. I've asked to see the official roster records at the University of Virginia, the Archives Department, but they refuse access. I mean, once I let it slip I was looking for a black Confederate spy, you know, they won't even accept my email anymore. This picture used to be prominently displayed at the University at Memorial Hall in New Orleans. I mean, right up front, you know, when people walked in. Now, like I said in the last video, if you call them and ask them about it, they get real stupid. They don't know what you're talking about, and after you describe it, they say it's privately owned, and they won't tell you who owns it. So I don't know if anybody really knows who this guy is and is just trying to hide it, but they don't want it out that Robert E. Lee had a black spy upon which he depended greatly. And I just think that's a disservice to history, you know, this whole sort of history of the Confederacy. In the whole relation with black people, I think it would change if people really knew the truth about this brilliant young man, brilliant and brave young man. Now I'm going to end this with Alabama Rebel Lady, in their version of Jeb Stuart's favorite song. They said he used to gallop around all the time singing it. This is one of the most important books to come out about the Civil War in a very long time. I highly recommend that you read it. This is the business of my friend and neighbor, Dave Trent. You know, they go to all the Civil War encampments in Northwest Louisiana, and they can travel into Arkansas and Texas if you're having an encampment and you'd like to invite them. Of course, if you need merchandise of this type, you can contact him at this number. Thank you.